Father Klaus Rummel, 28 years old at the time. He was at the Christian Training Seminary in Nagatsuka, 4,500 meters from the epicenter. Father Rummel, a German, was staying at the Nagatsuka Training Seminary as a theology student. Immediately after the bomb was dropped, he went to the church in Noboricho and joined the relief effort. The disastrous conditions created by the A-bomb deeply affected him, and afterwards he elected to be an educator. At present, Father Rummel serves as an administrator at the St. Sophia School. Back then, I was a theology student. I had just finished the second year of theology study. I evacuated from Tokyo and was staying at the Nagatsuka Jesuit Training Seminary in suburban Hiroshima. Food was scarce, just like for other Japanese, and my health was frail. It was that kind of era. August 6 was in the midst of summer recess. I finished breakfast by 8 a.m. and at 8:15 a.m. I was outside in front of the seminary. Let me tell you what I saw. The seminary was located on the hill, which was 50 to 60 meters high, near the city. I felt like a regular bomb had been dropped behind the hill. When the airplane was leaving, all of a sudden, a large sphere-like object in red, yellow, and purple appeared. When I saw that object, I thought a regular bomb had hit somewhere nearby, but I didn't hear an explosion. We had practiced a standby training before, and I thought it was strange. But as soon as a thought occurred to me, I was running down the stairs to the basement. On the way, a strap of my geta, sandal, snapped, and I became barefooted. At that moment, I felt hot air passing through above my head. It was a blast from the bomb. The blast knocked off 2/3 of the roof tiles. The glass panels of the windows, a total of 980, crashed down with a clamor. A part of the wall fell also. Those were the damages we suffered. When I came to, I wondered what in the world had happened. It may sound strange, but those were caused by the A-bomb. Anyhow, we survived. Of course, we didn't know it was caused by an A-bomb at the time. Up until then, while I was in Japan, I had never experienced being hit by a bomb. I don't know if this was good or bad. I had a few scratches on my body, and they were nothing serious. I climbed up the stairs from the basement and treated my injuries. When I went up to the top of the hill, I could see the entire city of Hiroshima. Everywhere was on fire. The nearby forest was also burning. The tile roof of a farmhouse in a town 500 meters from the seminary was on fire too. It was extinguished soon, though. Everyone understood the explosion was caused by some kind of new weapon. But no one talked about the A-bomb. No one could even imagine it was the A-bomb. While I was on the hilltop, Suddenly, a black cloud appeared, and it started raining. I could hear thunder, too. Young ladies who worked in the factory in Yokogawa came up to the hill, one after another. All of them had burns on the legs and arms where their skin was exposed. I thought we had to treat them first. In order to treat them, we needed various types of medication. Father Alpe, the head of the seminary, had some knowledge of medicine. He acted as a medical doctor. I was sent to look for physicians and nurses. However, when I went to them, all of them were dead. The Nagatsuka Elementary School looked like it had become a field hospital. People with injuries were gathered there. I thought we couldn't leave them alone. I picked up a sixth grade pupil on the roadside who had burns on his arms and legs, and carried him on my back. He didn't know where his parents and younger sister were. He said he escaped in a hurry, wondering what had happened. Afterwards, I didn't find any physicians and couldn't get any medications. There were many injured people evacuating along the national highway. Some couldn't continue any longer. I borrowed a car from the nearby farmhouse and carried two people at a time to the elementary school. We didn't have any medications, even if we wanted to treat the wounds. We disinfected the burns with a sterilizer. Then we applied some salad oil on top and placed a layer of gauze cloth. There was nothing else to treat them with. We repeated the treatment every day. A few dozen victims who had received our treatment didn't get keloids afterwards. Victims remained there until around December. There were some tragedies, though. A physician, an acquaintance of mine, came here with his head totally wrapped with a bandage. Only his eyes were visible, but on the second day, he collapsed and died. I don't know if it was from gangrene or radioactive contamination. I will never know. Also, there was a case of a boy 12 or 13 years old. This boy didn't have any burns or keloids on him. Suddenly, he complained of a severe headache. Then, a day or two later, he died. Eventually, we had to dispose of the dead bodies. Some people from the neighborhood were asked to help us. Among the people who had evacuated from the city, many collapsed and died in 4 to 5 days. There was a tree over there. Behind the tree, there was a 3-story inn. The inn was totally destroyed, and the roof was level with the road. Some people were walking on the rubble. Someone said voices could be heard inside the rubble. I went there, and I heard a voice calling for help. It was 8 p.m. It was a mother and 2 daughters. One of the daughters had a husband, but he seemed to have been killed instantly. But 3 of them were alive. We removed the tiles and other obstacles until we reached the bottom. It took us about 2 hours. Our goal was to rescue the injured. By the time we carried the three to the roadside, it was nearly 11 o'clock. Then there was another man, who, after his naturalization, converted his name to Inomiya LaSalle. He is still alive today and is about 90 years old. We took him to the park and carried him on a stretcher. We arrived at Nagatsuka at 3 in the morning. The dining room of the seminary was turned into an operating room. We treated the victims on the table. Father Alpe extracted 50 pieces of glass from the back of that person. Of course, we didn't have any anesthesia, but he held up strong. He also suffered from an injury, this big, on his leg. That's why he couldn't walk. Our house had a capacity of accommodating 24 or 25 people at the time. But we took in about 120 people. In the hallways, library, reception room, and even in the chapel, the victims were lined up. The ones who had collapsed stayed overnight. Most of the people we had taken in survived, but two. I didn't get any sleep that night, and I took off to the city at 8 a.m. the next morning. There were some valuable things buried in the Nobori Machi Church. I went there to dig them out. I bought some things afterwards and worked until 2 p.m. on the grounds of the Nobori Machi Church. Then I went back to Nagatsuka to go back to treating victims day and night. I didn't get any sleep for 3 days. I forgot about eating, too. We didn't have any nurses, so we had to do everything ourselves. There were numerous notices displaying the whereabouts of people along the national highway or just about everywhere. Most of the families were separated from their members, and many had no idea where the others had gone. And the dead ones didn't return home. There was a family exposed to the bomb fairly close to the epicenter. On the 7th, the mother went to the Shukeien Gardens, believing her daughter had been killed. But the girl, 12 or 13 years old, found her mother there. I saw them hugging each other. I started crying too. It was a consolation in the midst of sadness. But the majority of the people couldn't find family members after exhausting searches taking weeks and months. This has nothing to do with the A-bomb, but I am a German, a foreigner. Germany had lost the war 6 months earlier. We were all supposed to be detained in Taisha Kukyo under the order of the MP. If the U.S. forces landed nearby, we were all supposed to be killed. Originally, we had been protected by the Triple Alliance, but the Japanese government resented Germany for having lost the war. Actually, we were scheduled to go to Taisha Kukyo on the 6th. In preparation for this move, three people had gone there a week before, on July 31st. The rest of us were scheduled to go there later. But the MPs were positioned at the center of the city on the 6th. I heard that 50 of them had perished. Afterwards, the plan to detain us in the camp was scrapped because there were no MPs left to handle this. It was a strange coincidence, but our lives were saved by the A-bomb. After all, the A-bomb is a war itself. We have to think everything is intertwined with each other. As to how we humans must avoid war, we have to go back to the reason or causes of why a war starts. Otherwise, no peace will be established between the peoples. In short, there are two points I can mention. One is not to seek only national interest. It is a mass rationalism or mass selfishness, a so-called egoism. We have to overcome this and start internationally exchanging in trade, culture, and other areas. Young people need to profoundly understand the spirit of mutual concessions through discussions and agreements. The second is more metaphysical, but the ideologies can influence us deeply, and their confrontations. I, too, am a man of religion, but many religious wars have been fought in Europe, which by itself is a complete betrayal of true religious spirit. I believe we must make efforts to understand each other by overcoming ideological differences. I mean, let us overcome racial discrimination and tear down the walls of religions. The young people need to be educated, starting in their childhood, to be able to understand each other by overcoming racial differences. Over the 72 years of my life, it has been my biggest experience. Naturally, it has influenced my entire way of thinking, whether I realized it or not. My special subject is education, and I have taught ethics education in the university for a long time. I hope, somehow, the peace education will succeed and the conflicts between the South and North or the East and West will ease. As a matter of principle, my hope is to eliminate all the nuclear and atomic weapons. In reality, when the international politics come into play, a single person can't do anything. So I often and fully realize my helplessness.